Okay, Lance, you ready?
Yes, sir.
Good evening. Welcome to the November 15th meeting of your Board of Commissioners. Thank you for everyone here who's in attendance. We appreciate it. Tonight, our invocation is being led by Minister Rennie Salata, Leakesville United Methodist Church. And we heard from his wife at our last meeting in Reidsville, so we appreciate you being here as well. And after his invocation, I'll ask Bonnie Pergerson if she'll make her way to the podium and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. So if you're able to stand, please stand and remain standing. Minister.
Let us pray. God, beyond our understanding, but giver of wisdom to all, we ask that you would pour out your blessing of wisdom upon us tonight, that we would seek more to understand than to be understood, that in all of our deliberations here tonight, we would consider not only the practicalities and the facts, but the common good and the flourishing of all human life. We ask that this time would be a time of justice, a time of goodness, and a time of upbuilding for this community and all present here tonight. Amen.
Thank you. Please remain standing. Ms. Ferguson.
Please face the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As you know, we work from a prepared agenda, which has been published and is in front of us. Are there any changes to our agenda tonight? I don't have notice of any. So thank you, Ms. Clerk. With that, we'll accept a motion for approval of our agenda.
So moved.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Commissioners Richardson and Powell. With that, is all in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Thank you. We have an approved agenda. The next item is our consent agenda. Items on the consent agenda are non-controversial items. However, if anyone has questions about these items, please contact Lance Metzler, our county manager. Well, gentlemen, are there any items that the members want to remove from our consent agenda? Nothing heard. We'll accept a motion to approve the consent agenda. Thank you, Commissioner Travis. Is there a second?
Second.
I heard Commissioner Powell first. Thank you. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Very good. We have an approved consent agenda. The next item takes us to public comment. And we have one person signed up to speak tonight on public comment. I'll ask the county manager if he will read the protocol for public comment. Thank you, Mr. Metzler.
Sure, Mr. Chair. The public comment period shall be for the purpose of allowing members of the public to present any matter pertaining to county business or items on the Board of Commissioners agenda. Remarks shall be addressed directly to the Board of Commissioners and not to the staff, the audience, or medium. The chairperson shall open the public comment period. Any person who wishes to speak shall approach the podium, not speak from his or her seat. Each speaker shall clearly speak his or her name and physical address when he or she approaches the podium. Citizens shall be allotted 3 minutes. Citizens will be allowed to yield their time on a specific topic by utilizing one more attendee's time. This will allow no more than 6 minutes. Your time will be displayed on the monitor in front of you. The time clock will start with 3 minutes and less yielded time to 6 minutes. You will hear a beep at 1 minute to alert you to wrap up your comments. If you are to yield time or time is yielded to you, then please let the chairperson know in advance. Speakers are not allowed to campaign for public office, promote private business ventures, or use language of a personal nature which insults or demeans any person, or which, when directed at a public official, is not related to his or her official duties. The Board of Commissioners may accept written comments in lieu of oral statements. Written statements can be delivered to the County Manager's office. Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. And the first person signed up tonight is Doug Isley. Please come to the podium, state your name and address.
Thank you, Chairman. Doug Isley, 1790 Flat Rock Road, Reidsville.
Chairman and board members, I just wanted to come to you tonight to bring attention to an incident that happened this past week that involved our fire departments and a fire that we had here in the county. It was pretty substantial. I don't have the date down here, but False Recycling had a fire. They had a fire call come in around 10:41 a.m. All of Reidsville's fire departments responded, even some of the older units, I think, and the staff that they have responded as well. Pretty big fire. We had to get some assistance, or they had to get some assistance from the county. I've got them listed. I'm not going to list them in the order that they came to the fire, but we have 17 volunteer fire departments here in Rockingham County. Out of 17, we had 9 show up to that fire. They stayed out there from, I can't remember when the first truck got there, but they were there until about 11:30, 11:45, picked up their equipment, and Reidsville finished everything out. I think they finally left the scene around 5 a.m., somewhere around that. But I just want to thank all our volunteers, all our EMS workers, CCOM, 911 dispatchers. Without these folks in this county, that would have been a hot mess. And I had some folks call me and say, well, it was just a recycling center. But just adjacent to that big pile that was burning, they have the machine's around $9 million. And they saved that $9 million piece of equipment, which when the fire was under control, those employees got to come back to work the next day. So not only did they save a $9 million piece of equipment, they saved jobs. Right. I don't know how many we got working there, but I'd venture to say 15 to 30. But I want to thank Station 10, Station 20, Station 30, Station 40, Station 120, 150, 160, 170, and 210. Also, the county had EMS transport stage there. They had an admin member there. 502 was on the scene with a rehab for patient triage if needed. Reidsville Rescue was there for rehab. And of course, everybody at CCOM that helped communicate and get everything orchestrated. They had that thing under control. They were throwing water to it like nobody's business. And I think they pumped about 1.5 million gallons of water on that fire. I know there's sometimes issues with Reidsville reaching out to the county and they don't want to cross the line. I would hate to think what would have happened if this had been Annie Penn Hospital, God forbid, or Reidsville Senior High or South End. This was a pile of metal. I really wish that the city would kind of work with the county and get a automatic aid contract signed with the county so they get everything taken care of. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Isley. We appreciate you being here tonight and those good points you bring up. Mr. Isley is the only person who had signed up to speak during public comment. So with that, we're going to move to public hearings. With that, we have Hiram Marziano, our Community Development Director. Our first item is to amend the UDO to include options for indoor shooting range facilities to the table of uses and high impact use chart in section 63.01B.
Thank you. It was brought to our attention that we would like to do or amend the ordinances for an indoor shooting range. And while I felt that the current shooting range complex definition probably encapsulated indoor facilities, what it did not take into effect is they are arguably safer, less noisy. So we're proposing this amendment to add a specific language for indoor facilities while also reducing their impact on the high impact table. To that end, largely we're just adding indoor to the use table. None of the zones are changing. All the regulations that would apply to an outdoor shooting complex will also apply to an indoor facility. With the exception that it'll be under Class 2, which lowers the distance from neighboring properties that this facility would have to be set up at. It takes it down from, 1,000 to 500 feet. Relatively simple change.
Very good. Thank you. With that presentation, we will now open the public hearing for this item and allow anyone to speak. We have no one signed up to speak on this issue. Is there someone in the audience who would like to speak for or against this? Nothing seen. We will close the public hearing. Gentlemen, are there any comments or questions?
I'll make a motion, Mr. Chairman.
Travis?
Make a motion to approve the amended for the UDO for indoor shooting range.
Thank you, Commissioner Travis. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Commissioner Powell. We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion or questions? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next issue, Margiano?
Yes, sir. This is a amendment proposed for the zoning enforcement procedures, basically to bring it in line with our solid waste ordinance procedures. A lot of times code enforcement will go out for one zoning violation. They'll find solid waste out there, a violation of solid waste, and it's two separate procedures. They're running multiple citations, multiple cases. This is basically just to streamline it all into one uniform process that we're applying across multiple ordinances. A lot on that slide, I apologize. We do establish the penalty fees for this, which are $75 for the first citation. $150 for the second citation, $300 for the third citation, and then $300 per day every after cumulative following that, which is slightly different than currently. That follows the solid waste ordinance. Currently, any zoning violation starts at $100 and continues with $100 per day. So it's slightly different on that part of it.
Okay, very good. With that, we will open a public hearing, and there is no one signed up to speak on this issue either. Is there anyone in attendance who would like to speak to it? Nothing seen. So, gentlemen, any questions or is there a motion?
I'll make a motion. I'd just like to say, Marzi, thank you for finally getting to this. This has been needed for a while. But I'll make a motion to amend the UDO section 37.01. Right.
But before we accept that, I will close the public hearing. I apologize. And now that motion from Commissioner Travis
still
is on
stands,
the table.
Yeah.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Commissioner Berger. Any further questions or discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. All right, item number three, Mr. Marzi.
This is, I believe there was, during the recent adoption of the UDO, there was a little bit of oversight in the residential densities table. At least that's what I think happened. What was missing was when you have public water and public sewer, there was a null entry in the RA and the RP zones, which theoretically means that nobody could hook on or tap onto those facilities, which I don't believe was the intent. I also feel that since we have been allowing people in the past to rezone to RP, that we have several RP subdivisions out there, which are all just single detached, single family residential detached, but it needed a more dense calculation if there is allowed water and sewer that are public there. So what we've proposed to do in here is drop down the 1.7 from just when it just has public water, for RA, and do a 5 unit per acre for RP, to kind of give it a medium density quality. It was also brought up at a TRC meeting that some of the situations that we need to account for may be that there's well, but there might be public sewer available. So we've offered to add that line in there under the middle row, so those densities would still apply. Let's say if there was no public water, but there is public sewer. So we're trying to account for all situations.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Marziano. With that, we will open the public hearing. And we have no one signed up to speak. Is there anyone here who would like to speak? Nothing seen. We will open the public. Well, we did open it, didn't we? So we'll close it. Boy, we'll keep up with all this. So anyway, guys, any questions? Is there a motion?
Make a motion.
Thank you, Commissioner Powell. Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Thank you, Commissioner Richardson. Any more questions? Nothing heard. All in favor, say yes.
Yeah. Yes.
There we go. All opposed, no. Just trying to be sure you're paying attention. All righty. Very good. Motion carries. Thank you. I would like to point out to everyone that this is exactly what we talked about when we adopted this UDO this summer. is that there would be changes, and there will be continual changes with this document. It's a living document. As we find things that need to be adjusted, we will address them on a regular basis. So thank you for bringing these to us tonight. We appreciate it.
Thank you all very much. Have a good evening.
Thank you. That takes us to public hearing D, Carrie Taylor Penix. Good evening.
How are y'all?
Fine, thank you.
So this is a public hearing for Gregory Pallet and Lumber Company. We're requesting an appropriation from the general fund not to exceed $36,000. It would be spread out over 5 years for this project. They're looking to invest $2.5 million in capital improvements and hire 25 full-time employees. This is going in the North Star Shell Building, and it has been vacant since 2002.
That's good.
So that's a good location for this project, and we'll ask for your support of this performance agreement for them.
Thank you, Ms. Penix. All right, with that, we will open our public hearing on this item, and we have no one signed up to speak. Is there anyone here who would like to speak, two or four? Yeah, but nothing heard. So, gentlemen, we will entertain a motion.
Close the meeting.
Thank you. Public hearing is closed.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to approve the performance agreement with Gregory Pallet, and I appreciate them coming here and taking over that business, and I wish them luck, and if the county can do anything to help them, please let them know.
I will. This is their first North Carolina operation, so they have four locations in Virginia, so we're welcome. Look forward to it.
Very good. We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Commissioner Richardson. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, nay. Very good. Motion carries. Thank you.
And I would like to remind everybody that the county is hosting a job fair. It will be located in our facility, 425 NC Highway 65, back behind the governmental center, Wednesday, 10 to 4. And I understand that there are multiple county departments that will be there on site taking applications of anybody looking for jobs. So just Great. Wanted to make sure everybody knew that.
Thank you. We appreciate you being here tonight.
Got a lot
Thank
of
you.
Jobs out there. We're going to get them filled.
Brings us to item number 8, presentation on Rockingham County Health Insurance Program. Ms. Nixon.
Good evening, Chairman Hall, Vice Chair, and Commissioners. Mr. Metzler, thank you very much for having me here tonight. My name is Donna Nixon, and I am with Pierce Group Benefits. And Pierce Group is one of your partners that helps arrange and manage your employee benefits package. We're proud to work in partnership with you to design and help build a cost-effective benefits package that will help you attract and retain your talented employees. So our comprehensive one-stop model encompasses all the different components of benefit administration, from consulting to employee education. We recently met with your leadership team regarding your health plan, and today I'd like to just share a brief overview of some of that information. For most of this presentation, we're going to illustrate information about the last two plan years, which coincide with your fiscal year of July to June. Overall, the demographics have remained very stable. You have a high percentage of dependents on the plan, which means that your plans are attractive to those with families. Many of your peers have struggled to structure a plan which is affordable for those with dependents. So I commend you for making those decisions to really encourage those with dependents to be enrolled on the plan. Your average age is in line with other public sector groups, and just generally speaking, the younger the average age, the less claims that are incurred. And as far as gender composition, your plan has a split of about 60-40, female to male. This chart illustrates the breakdown of where your dollars are being spent. The most recent plan year is in red, and the prior plan year is in blue. You can see that the inpatient professional services and pharmacy all had substantial increases in this most recent plan year, and we'll review some of those details on the next slide. So based on the timing and the different methods of claim reporting, there are some variances on this slide compared to the previous. However, in regards to admissions, although the number of admissions dropped from 59 to 50, you can see that the average length of stay on an inpatient basis increased by about 44% from 3.8 days to 5.5 days. So meaning when those participants were in the hospital, their average length of stay increased to 5.5 days. The outpatient surgeries and office visits were pretty stable, and some good news, your emergency room costs decreased by about 37%. One trend that we have seen across the country as a direct result of the pandemic is the increase in telehealth services. That's where participants are able to access care with their doctors from home or from their offices using a computer or mobile device. You can see the number of those visits increased from 320 in 1 year up to 900, so almost three times. That is the most affordable cost of care, so that's a really good thing. And then lastly, you can see that although the number of prescriptions decreased, there was an increase of about 30% in the number of specialty prescriptions filled. That is what accounts for the increase in the total costs. This slide just provides an alternate view of how the dollars are being spent across the plan. Of the most concern is the pharmacy utilization. We are exploring some additional options, and we'll be reviewing some additional programs for consideration with your leadership team in the next couple of weeks. That is one area that we are looking to make some enhancements on to improve the results in that category while maintaining the cost structure for the employees and the dependents on the plan. The big components of your large increase is due to the increase in frequency and cost of the high-cost claimants. In this most recent plan year, the plan had an increase of claims of over $25,000 from 57 to 75, meaning the number of claims over 10,000 increased from 8 to 14. You did have one claim well over $1 million in this last plan year.
Wasn't me.
Now we're going to shift gears just slightly to just provide an overview of the first quarter results of this plan year, which started in July. As we would expect, the pharmacy is continuing on the current trend, but the good news is the inpatient spend is below the benchmark. So that inpatient spend is about 12%. We like to see that number under 20%. So that's a really good sign right now. As far as the large claimant report goes, the number of claimants over $25,000 this early in the plan year is of some concern with 16. We will continue to monitor the utilization and provide updates to the leadership team in that regard. And then many groups that we work with have expressed interest in tracking expenses directly related to COVID claims. So this report provides demographic information for both vaccinations and treatment of those with a COVID diagnosis since the pandemic started through October 9th of 2021. Keep in mind that this report only captures the services specifically coded as COVID that were processed through the health plan. As I mentioned earlier, our team is working very diligently along with your leadership team to continue to look at strategic changes that we can make to the plan to help you all with your results. You all really have been kind of a trendsetter among your peers as far as how you've structured your program. You all have your health clinic, as you are aware. That really does help your employees with their chronic conditions. That has been running very, very well. And then you have a third-party administrator that manages your claims and provides the provider network, and then you have a pharmacy benefit manager as well. So all of those components allow you to have a lot of flexibility in how you structure your program. We're going to continue to look at most heavily the prescription program this year to see what changes can be made there to bring some relief to the high cost of claims that have been incurred this last year or so. I want to thank you very much for your time and attention this evening. Thank you for letting me be here.
Thank you, Ms. Nixon. We appreciate your presentation. Gentlemen, do you have any questions for Ms. Nixon? Nothing seen, so thank you very much.
Very much.
Appreciate y'all being
thank
here.
Thank you.
All right, we're on item number 9. Tom McNish, CPA, Elliot Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Commissioners. Appreciate the chance to be with you this evening to do a brief summary of the financial statement audit for the year ended June 30, 2021. Going to start off just covering some high-level financial highlights from your annual financial report, and then also cover the required communications that, as your auditors, by the auditing standards, we're required to communicate with you directly as the governing board, and then just briefly cover the audit results. One thing noteworthy that I would like to, first of all, thank your finance team and Ms. Galloway for all their hard work to get us through the process. As you know, it's a long and arduous process, and they have to keep their day-to-day going and still get us what we're asking for as well. And we had no reportable findings this year, which is a testament to the team and to your management team. And so I wanted to start off by just pointing that out. So nothing in the way of what we would call significant deficiencies or material weaknesses related to your internal controls over your financial reporting or your grant compliance. So good news there. So just some brief variance analysis on your revenues and expenditures for the general fund. So revenues did increase by about $4.5 million or 5%. Likewise, expenditures increased, but only to 4.2% or about $3.4 million. There was an increase in transfers out of the general fund of about $2.5 million, or about 48%. And all those things equated to an overall increase in your fund balance of just shy of $3 million, or about 7%. In comparison to budget for the general fund, so revenues were just about right on budget, and then expenditures were significantly less than budget by about 18%, or about $18.5 million. When we're looking at fund balance, your finance team and the LGC, they have certain, as y'all know, certain parameter standards that you want to maintain for fund balance as far as having a reserve. The county is has a good healthy reserve in fund balance, and really what you're looking for specifically is that available fund balance. So there's certain portions of your fund balance that are restricted, so they can only be used for certain legally required purposes. So if I'm looking at this slide here, and this is a comparison with fiscal years 20 and 21, so The litmus test for the GFOA, and that's the Government Financial Officers Association, so they say that you should have about 2 months of expenditures, general fund expenditures in reserve. And the way they calculate that is, for instance, in the 2021 column, with about $93 million in expenditures for fiscal year 2021, including transfers. If you divide that by 12, then you end up with a very rough monthly expenditure burn, okay? And so if you take that and divide it into your available fund balance, that's giving the county roughly four months, of fund balance that theoretically could be used in an emergency. It's a reserve fund. So doing pretty well. It's different for each county or each local government, but according to GFOA, they're saying you should have a minimum of two. So the county is clear of that, which is a good indicator. Then the local government commission here in North Carolina says that you should have a reserve of at least 8%. The county, your own policy is a little bit more conservative than that, and you have a reserve of 16%. Well, you've exceeded both of those, both in 20 and 21, and I think going back, you're keeping a healthy reserve above both those benchmarks if you're looking at those. So switching away from the general fund and just looking at some variances on your water fund. So revenues increased a little bit in the water fund by about 3.7% or $22,000. Expenses increased of about 20% or $131,000. Net position, though, still increased. So that's kind of your equity position, still increased by about 36%. That was largely driven, though, by a governmental grant, just shy of about $5 million, which is a good thing, that was used for projects and infrastructure development. And so that's why you do have that overall increase in net position. Looking at the ins and outs for the cash that's available in the water fund, so the cash that was used for operations was about $315,000. You had transfers out of the water fund of about $404,000. And then the net of money that came in from your capital grant and then expenditures for infrastructure and capitalized items, that netted to about $43,000. And then cash invested or cash from return on investments was about $7,000. So you had a net cash decrease of about $668,000. On the sewer fund, revenues decreased by about almost 6%, $34,000. Expenses were up by about 14%. Again, you did have some capital grant funding that came in, which drove net position up, even though you had a net decrease if you look at your revenues and expenses. On the cash side, cash used for operations, about $675,000. Transfers into the fund from other funds, about $567,000. And then net cash used for those infrastructure projects, about $680,000. On the landfill, revenue increased by about 3.3%. Expenses decreased there about 26%. Net position also decreased by about $1.4 million or about 11%. And then cash provided by operations from the landfill fund was about $961,000, transfers in of $6,800, and then cash used for infrastructure capital or for landfill maintenance and capital expenditures about $550,000. Cash for investing activities about $77,000 for a net of about $340,000. So just briefly on the audit process, just to take you through that as part of our required communications, we do, as you would guess, a lot of audit planning before we start to ask the finance team for audit evidence. We do employ a materiality threshold, so we're not looking at 100% of the transactions or the balances that occur throughout the fiscal year. We're going to do this on a sample basis for efficiency and to make sure that we're addressing the proper audit risks. Your internal controls over your financial reporting
Those are very important to us. So these are the day-to-day activities that your finance team and your grants and compliance team exercise every day. We want to see what kind of shape those are in. Are they strong? If you've got strong internal controls, then that's obviously going to be a positive. That's less risk. If you've got weaker internal controls in some areas, that tells us that we're going to have to do more audit work there because the day-to-day procedures may not be as strong. So our responsibility is to provide our opinion as to whether the financial statements are fairly presented in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. And those are the same rules that any finance team for a municipal or county government would use to build their financial statements and to report on those financial statements. We do look at the significant accounting policies. Those are some of the items that you'll find in the footnotes to the financial report. We want to make sure those are reasonable, that they're in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. So we audit those and look at those significant accounting policies to make sure that they make sense. So contrary to popular belief, accounting and financial reporting is not an exact science. Your management team does use estimates. Things like depreciation or OPEB liability, those types of things are based on estimates. We want to evaluate as the auditors whether those estimates are based on a reasonable assumption. So we do procedures to determine that. I mentioned the financial statement disclosures. Those are all those footnotes that are included in that very comprehensive financial report. And we audit those as well, make sure that they're providing context to the exhibits and to the financial statements and that they tie in and they support those financial statements. We look at any unrecorded or uncorrected misstatements. We want to see if they're material. Those are the ones that we're worried about, is whether there's a misstatement that is material that would cause a user of the financial statements to be misled. So if I'm a bondholder or somebody who's sophisticated in looking at that document, I'm familiar with all those rules, but if there's a misstatement in there that would even throw me off as a sophisticated user, that's the thing that we're looking for, and that's what we want to be able to give our opinion, that there aren't material misstatements for the financials to be presented fairly in accordance with the proper rules. At the end of the process, we're going to ask for written representations from your management team, attesting to certain facts and circumstances as we've gone through the audit process. If we have any disagreements with management that we can't resolve, we would be required to come to you as the governing board and get those issues resolved. We had nothing like that. We're not aware of any consultations with other accountants or auditors. This might happen if there was a circumstance or event that we did not have the expertise as your auditors to resolve or to work through. So we weren't aware of the need for that outside consultation. We discussed a lot of significant issues with management as it applies to your compliance and to your financial reporting. I think those were all good expected exchange and conversations that we would want to see in a healthy audit process, and those were productive. Again, we didn't encounter any difficulties in performing the audit. If we felt like we weren't getting correct information, if we were being stonewalled, if we weren't having a fluid process, we would be required to come to you, let you know about that, and then see how we would resolve that. But we had nothing like that. As I mentioned, good news that we found no significant deficiencies or material weaknesses. And other than, I think, our engagement letter, and our representation letter, there was no other formal written communication or other written documentation between us and your management team. So just real quick on we essentially have four different reports that we issue. I mentioned the financial statement audit opinion, and that's simply where we're giving our opinion as to whether the financial statements are fairly presented, and that's important for bondholders, investors, people who are interested in the financial condition of the county to be able to pick that up and say, all right, well, there's a third party that evaluated that financial condition and reported on it. As a local government, you're subject to Yellow Book or government auditing standards. I mentioned internal controls. That's a very important part of the Yellow Book audit, or an audit performed in accordance with the Yellow Book. We're very interested in those controls.
and to make sure that they're working properly and that there's not a risk or a lack of controls that could result in a material misstatement that we talked about or a material noncompliance. So as I mentioned, we didn't identify any deficiencies in internal controls that we would consider to be significant or material, and that's a good thing. I mentioned grants and grant compliance. So I think this year the county, and this is a very good thing, was able to make use of approximately $20 million, a little over $20 million in state and federal grants. A lot of new programs out there with the pandemic and CARES Act funding. So you also tasked us with going in and auditing to see whether, in this case, we were giving our opinion as to whether the county was materially in compliance with those grant requirements. So a whole separate audit process that we go through to tackle that and to give you our opinion as to whether the county was materially in compliance. For your major programs, good news there is we were able to give an opinion that we felt the county was materially in compliance with those requirements. One thing that's new, and this is imposed by the Local Government Commission this year, and I think all of our county and municipal clients are going to be dealing with this in different ways, but the Local Government Commission wanted to employ a set of ratios, their own ratios, for a determination of how the county is faring in certain financial respects. So these are both the ratios themselves and then whether or not the ratios are considered what the LGC is calling indicators of concern. These are all based on LGC criteria. Now, what they've said the contracted audit firm, in this case Elliott Davis, has to do is to report to you those ratios and whether there were indicators that would qualify as indicator of concern. So the county, under that criteria, did have one of those, and I would comment that this is a very conservative calculation that they use. So one of the benchmarks that they say is if you take, for in this case, your water and sewer fund, and you look at your bottom line, so your net income or loss, you're going to add on to that whatever debt service you would have. Now, normally debt service is not an expense, only to the extent that there's interest, but the principal payments would not normally show up or would not show up under GAAP in your net income or net loss, okay? So if you had a net loss of $100,000 and you had $1 million in debt service, well, under the financial rules, you would only have $100,000 loss because that's principal repayment like you would with your home mortgage or whatever the case may be. Well, for the LGC's indicator, they're wanting to add that $1 million, or in this case, about $1.2 million in debt payment, to where you end up with something less than zero. And so, in other words, you end up with an adjusted net income or net loss that's either goes from being net income to a big loss, or it goes from being maybe a small loss to a bigger loss. So I know it's kind of different in terms of how they come up with that calculation, but they're wanting to look at that. They're saying if you have if it's not greater than zero, so if you're not break even with that principal payment adjustment or higher, then that has to be reported as an indicator of concern. I think there's going to be more guidance on this. This will be the first year that the LGC has done this. I would say that there are probably going to be a number of counties, especially ones that have enterprise funds, water and sewer funds, that may be experiencing that same indicator. It's hard to say right now, but this is something that there'll probably be some movement, maybe some changes on. It's hard to say. But we were required to include that in our reporting to you. And, Mr. Chairman, I can take any questions that the commissioners may have.
Thank you. Gentlemen, do we have any questions? Nothing heard. Well, let me say thank you for your presentation. We appreciate it. And I'd like to commend staff and administration. We appreciate the good job you guys are doing. So thank you all very much. Thank you, sir, for being here.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
All righty, that takes us to item number 10 with Jennifer Brown and Shane Bullins. Good evening, Sheriff.
I've invited my staff to be here. I'm going to speak just for a little bit about where we're at on our mental health, behavioral health program in the jail side and also the community program. I have Mr. Artie Light here. We'll speak just a little bit from the Daymark perspective because it is a partnership. But as you know, Rockingham County has a need for increasing behavioral health capacity in our local sheriff's office, particularly in our jail. And also we have a need also in our communities. I've been in law enforcement a long time. And I've seen from when we had mental health reform back in the early 2000s, how that affected us here in our communities. And I've seen the failures in those systems, and I've seen us go through these different LMEs and stuff. But I believe we got a workable program here, working with former Commissioner Keith Duncan with the support of the commissioners, with the support of Phyllis Safaro with DSS, thanking our county manager, also Artie Light, Ashley Gold, Captain Bullins and Captain Brown, working as a team, we'd have been able to find the funding to try to bring two clinicians, one into the jail and one in a community model, working with our officers out in the field to improve the level of services and behavioral health support and also referral and support in those capacities. And right now we are seeking, and I can let Mr. Light speak to this, we are seeking to try to locate two clinicians to work those programs. But right now I believe that we still are in the Artie is still in the looking phase. I think that's consistent with what we're seeing a lot around the country and around this community. But we are looking, and it is our hopes to, when this person do come on board, is to, again, you know, I've talked to you before about reducing those situations where we have suicide and mental health issues and addiction issues that are coming together in our jail for a perfect storm, and not being able to provide services to stabilize this person when our jail, because in our jails, as you know, we are responsible for those persons that are in our jail to look after those persons until they get out, and hopefully we can refer them and link them to services when they get out, because we've got to break that cycle. We also got to work out in the community trying to break the cycle there too. And there's some people that are getting picked up in our communities or getting arrested that truly have mental health concerns, but they're getting arrested when they really need to be in a mental health, either inpatient or outpatient referral, but they're ending up in the jail system, whereas really that's not the best place to treat people. And so right now, kind of where we're at is, first of all, we have received the funding through the reinvestment dollars for 2 years. It's $284,000. It's a two-year program. And part of the program, working with Daymark, when our information is in, I think after the first year, we'll be assessing to see where we're at, and hopefully we'll be able to see if it's any additional grants or other type funding to continue this program. But right now, we're looking at the support from the reinvestment dollars, federal dollars, for 2 years to run this program. So, you know, anything we can do to improve the level of mental health services in our, either in our jail or out in the community, I think is a plus for Rockingham County. Because everybody out there that has these situations, that you're dealing with these demons, they're somebody's family, somebody's loved one. And Artie, would you like to say a few words?
Artie summed it up.
Thank you, Mr. Commissioner, Mr. Minister, excuse me. Daymark is actively recruiting. We've been doing that for the last 3 or 4 months. Very difficult right now to find qualified individuals. I'm looking for the right people to put in these positions. I think I have two to interview this week, two to interview next week, and hopefully out of those four, we can get two for this program. That's my goal anyway. Thank you.
Any questions? Thank
you, Jennifer.
Any questions?
I've got a comment. I'd like for you to just share with the public the credentials you're looking for in these individuals.
Okay. Apologize. Right now, I'm looking for fully licensed clinicians, LCSWAs, LCSWs, LCASs, licensed clinical addiction specialists, licensed marriage family therapists. All of those could fit in those positions. I would prefer to not hire someone who is not fully licensed. That's because of the ethical issues.
Mr. Chair, the...
Well, yeah, let me ask you, now, are we looking for a motion to approve this program? Is that what we're looking for
what
tonight?
What you're doing is you're approving the concept you, that you agree with the direction they're going, because Sand Hills Center, before they go any further, they need to have the board's commitment that they're fine with the program as stated by the sheriff and Artie.
Okay. Y'all clear?
The reinvestment funds that most counties get through the LME MCOs.
Right, right. So we need a motion to approve this in concept, is
yes.
that right?
Yes, sir.
All right, gentlemen, we're clear. We'll accept a motion at this time then.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any further questions or comments?
Just one. Artie, you going to be with us for a transition meeting
Wednesday,
2 o'clock?
I wasn't aware of it, but yes, sir, I can be.
You are now.
You're aware of it now, but it doesn't have to be you. It just has to be somebody that can speak on behalf of Daymark, because I think it's important. Sand Hills will be there, and they need to know what your interests are. They might be able to help you with your recruitment process.
Artie, I think it's going to be in here at the same time, the way we had it last time, in this boardroom.
Very good. We've got a motion and a second. We've had comments. So all in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed. Thank you, folks. We appreciate y'all being here tonight.
Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
With that, that takes us to item 11, Lance Metzler.
All right, Mr. Chair, I'd ask that Pat Galloway and Paul come up here to correct me if I say anything incorrect, because we all worked on this proposal together. In your packet, you have the COVID premium pay policy, the budget change, and the ARPA American Rescue Plan grant project ordinance. Okay, Paul, go to slide 2. A policy is required by uniform guidance prior to spending any ARPA funds for COVID premium pay. This policy also includes actions that you all previously took by allowing us to compensate EMS for taking additional shifts to ease the burden from the lack of staff. This policy is recommended to show appreciation to employees for the work done responding to COVID-19. We took a tiered approach to recognize those who were frontline versus those who are highly impacted and those who are low to moderate impacted. Paul? I'm recommending that the frontline staff receive a one-time bonus of $1,200, and examples of those would be EMS, deputies, adult protective services, child protective services. I'm recommending an $800 one-time bonus to those that had moderate exposure to COVID-19. Some of those examples are those who worked the clinics, those that had regular contact with staff and citizens. And then the final recommendation is a one-time bonus of $500, recognizing that all staff were deemed essential, and we never closed offices one time during the pandemic. Slide 4. The key criteria, employees must be employed in a permanent position at the time the bonus is issued. The employee must have worked at least 50% of regular time in person in a permanent position from July 1, 2020 to June 30th of 2021. Employees with annual earnings over $75,000 will require additional justification prior to consideration, as several were strong leaders during the pandemic. All department heads and supervisors must attest to the appropriate bonus level for each employee. Slide 5. The estimated cost is approximately $525,000, but I would ask that the board provide flexibility in my determination of eligibility. So I'm seeking you all approve utilizing no more than $575,000. $500,000 would come from the ARPA funds. $75,000 would potentially come from the county COVID funds. There are a few revisions that I need to point out from the policy that's in your packet. Employees with average earnings over $75,000, originally we said weren't going to be considered, but after further discussion, I think that we've got many staff persons that did contribute quite a bit. Add a new record retention section to be in compliance with ARPA requirements. Removed a bullet regarding the election employees and replaced with eligible employees or county employees that are either directly or indirectly under the supervision of the county manager, the sheriff, or the register of deeds. Also wanted to point out for clarification on the grant project ordinance, it reflects that $17,147,626 as uncommitted. However, we are, there are capital projects that we plan to commit these remaining funds to, and we'll bring them back to you all in the near future. Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. We appreciate that. Gentlemen, any questions or comments? Commissioner Richardson?
Basically, all county employees are considered here. I didn't hear any mention of clerk of court. Is that taken care of elsewhere?
That's state employees.
Thank you.
Any questions? Comments?
Hey, I got a question.
Mr. Travis?
Pretty much a comment. From the start of this, Manager, since we didn't give a bonus during COVID to our county employees, is, you know, I feel like we're lowballing them here with the $1,200. I mean, are we taking taxes and retirement out of this funds when we give it to them?
Absolutely.
So you're looking at, instead of $1,200, you're probably looking at only $800 for the top person? I just feel like that's low, very low for the amount of what our employees do for the county, how they represent our county. I just feel like we're shorting them. It was my recommendation to do 2,000, but it is what it is, because I'm only one vote on this board. But county employees, I appreciate you. I really do, and I know the citizens of Rockingham County appreciate you, and I hope you notice how these votes go for the next election. And take note, because there's 600 and some employees out there that know who's on this board, who actually cares about you, who actually wants to see you do better. I will tell you that we're working on some things. Hopefully, I'm hoping in the future we can offer 401k. I hope we can offer a better pay for you too, because everybody in this whole county knows everything's going up. I mean, it's pretty bad. You can work for the county and someone at McDonald's can make more money than you can. But I wish my board appreciated that more. But evidently, they got little pet projects they need to do before they help the county employees. So I will be voting for this because I want to see you get something. But please take note.
Any more comments, questions?
Mr. Manager, just for public information, we did do some raises for our employees. One-third was the initial grouping.
That's correct, and you all have instructed staff to go for the other two-thirds, and that's what we've done.
And I'd like to point out, or it might be better for you to point out, these are going to be permanent raises, and they're going to eventually cover all of the staff.
Thank you, Commissioner. Any other comments? With that, we'll open the floor for a motion. Is there a motion?
So moved.
We have a motion on the floor. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Commissioner Berger and Commissioner Richardson. All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you very much. Appreciate that, County Manager.
Yes, sir.
With that, we have, is there any new business?
Yes, sir.
John. Yes, Mr. Chair, members of the board, it was handed to legal last week, an easement for your review. I believe it's in front of you with Duke Energy. This is a basic easement involving power lines. Mr. Tate is, I don't believe he's here tonight to further explain, but from a legal review perspective, it's a basic easement for your review and vote.
Mr. Chair, I believe this easement is for the placement of a power pole to provide power to help incorporated, and the easement is through our property.
Yes.
Unless there are questions, I'm pleased to move approval.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Commissioner Richardson and Commissioner Powell. We have a motion and a second. Any comments or questions? All in favor say yes. Yes. All opposed?
And Mr. Chair, maybe in the future, the board might consider either giving the county manager or the chairperson to sign off on these easements, because we get easements like this quite often.
Well, we can do that now, can we?
I don't see why not.
I make a motion to give county manager authorization to talk about easement.
Let's do this. Let's let the county attorney draft something so we can be sure that it's worded properly and vetted, and let's take that up at our next meeting.
Certainly.
Is that okay?
I make that motion to do that.
All right. Thank you, Commissioner Travis. Is there a second for that?
Second.
Thank you, Commissioner Richardson. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed. Very good. Thank you. I appreciate that. With that, we'll move to commissioner comments. And we'll start off with Commissioner Travis.
As usual. As usual. I'd like to thank everybody for being here, especially county employees. I know I can speak for me. I appreciate what you do. It's hard out there sometimes when you feel like you've got leadership that don't really appreciate you. But I do appreciate you, and I wish there's more I could do. But like I said before, I'm one vote. But you are a bunch of votes. Just remember that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Commissioner Travis. Commissioner Richardson?
I have a few things to share. First of all, this is in the form of a public of an announcement. For the general public information, all of you that are interested, you may be aware of 1,600 plus houses are being proposed to be built in the southwestern corner of our county, just off of I-73. There will be an informational meeting running from 4:30 to 5:30 p.m. on Thursday, the 18th of November, at Huntsville School, and it'll be a drop-in sort of meeting, so you should be able to bring your questions and find out exactly what's being proposed there as far as that development is concerned. I'd like to make mention of Veterans Day. Some members of this board participated in various Veterans Day programs. The county, I think, is to be commended. At least I think they should be commended because of their diligence in supporting the veterans of the county and having these various ceremonies. You may have gone to an individual ceremony at your church, or there was a ceremony last Sunday here at the Veterans Park. The veterans of Eden brought in the moving wall for recognition of the Vietnam vets, and that was at Freedom Park. Week and a half ago, the parade, and there are actually a couple parades. I participated in one over in Madison, in addition to the numerous church services. And I just thought, Mr. Chairman, it was appropriate to recognize in the last year, this county had three World War II veterans that were over 100 years old, two of which passed in 2021, leaving us with just one. And so I look forward to the opportunity to honor that individual and others. Finally, if you haven't picked up through the paper or other sources, we're in the midst of the Red Kettle campaign. And perhaps Chairman Hall will talk more about that. But we basically look to get over $100,000. It's one of my favorite charities. I've already contributed to it this year. Because I feel like my money, every bit of it, goes directly to the children of Rockingham County. So I encourage you, when you get a chance, to support the Red Kettle campaign sponsored by the Salvation Army of Rockingham County. I yield.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Powell?
Yes, so under the consent agenda, Deputy Franklin Martin is retiring from the Rockingham County Sheriff's Office effective January 1st of next year. With over 20 years of service, we want to wish him luck in his future endeavors and thank him for his service to the county as well. And Thomas Curry retired from the Fire Marshal's office, and we wish him the same thing. And I'd just like to say that I have the utmost respect for our EMS and fire department personnel and 911 communicators. I listen to the scanner some. I listen to you guys and see what's going on. I know when you don't have enough units in the county, and I know when Mr. Cates is riding the truck. I do listen to that two or three times a week, and you do a remarkable job juggling the resources that you have for the people of this county, and I just want to tell you how much I appreciate that. And to the rest of our county employees, I certainly hope that as we go into the budget session this year, we can do some more permanent things for you in regards to your benefits and your pay. I believe that it's needed, and I have been certainly a champion for that cause. It probably would be much better to do something on a permanent basis than on a one-time basis. So I do appreciate the hard work you're doing. I know COVID presented you some various problems and concerns that you had to work through, and we're very proud of the work that you've done and how you make this county run, because it is you. I have employees, I have a business, and I know the value of our employees, and it's a significant return on my investment, and I think it's a significant return on the investment of this county. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Powell. Commissioner Berger.
Thank you, Commissioner Hall. Just want to recognize a few of our elected officials in attendance. Have Doug Isley and Paula Rakestraw from the school board, and everyone saw our sheriff, Sam Page, came up front and did a presentation earlier. Appreciate y'all being here. Speaking of the Christmas and holiday season, we have a number of adults and kids in foster care or DSS care. A lot of these adults and kids would benefit from just a small contribution. Could bring a big smile to both faces, the adults and the kids. So if you would like to contribute, you could contact DSS at 342-1394. And if you want to contribute to the adult end, that's Bridget Yoho, her extension 7170. And for children, it's Kelsey Bowman, extension 7090. So anyone out there listening, certainly would be of benefit to some of our residents if you could help out. Also want to just mention Ms. Pat Galloway. I believe in 20 years of working with local governments and probably about five audits, listening to that entire presentation, this may be the first time I've heard of one that did not have any dings. So certainly congratulations to Ms. Galloway and her hard work and keeping all that straight. So thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. I agree with your comments. Thank you, Pat. Thank you, staff, again, for the hard work you do. I know we've talked in the past how that, you know, one simple slip of paper in DSS could get you five or seven dings on an audit. So something that simple didn't show up this year. So thank you, guys. Thank you, everyone, for your efforts. That's very important. And, as Commissioner Richardson said, the Salvation Army Red Kettle campaign kickoff has kicked off earlier this month. You'll see the kettles. Please be generous. This money is used throughout the year to help kids in Rockingham County, and not just at Christmas time, but all through the year. So be generous if you can. It's a great cause, and the money is very well utilized. And I'll echo the other comments that commissioners have made, that yes, you know, we've granted salary increases so far this year to staff. We're evaluating the balance. Instead of doing it over the next several years, we're gonna do it this year. We're doing it now. So we're making that effort to improve wages, to improve benefits. So we think that'll have a longer lasting impact for the employees of the community. So with that, we will say that our next meeting is December 6th, 6:30 here at the Governmental Center. And we will now accept a motion to adjourn.
Make a motion.
Thank you, Commissioner Powell. Is there a second? Come on, somebody.
I'll second that.
Thank you, Commissioner Richardson. With that, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.